Welcome back to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis, the image to macro programming part, and this part will be about conditions and loops. So I introduced earlier that image processing workflows usually look like that. That's not true. Unfortunately, image processing workflows are very often more complicated. So it's not a linear thing where you start at one step and then you come to a certain endpoint. In many cases, we have to differentiate different situations. We do for this image, we do that. For the other image, we do it a bit different, or yeah, depends, right? And in order to write some code which can depend on conditions, and we use conditions and loops. Let's start with the conditional statement first. So if you want to write a piece of code which is only executed under some circumstances, you use the if statement. So the computer reads the program from the top to the bottom and does what you say. So it starts by doing something and it reaches at some point a line which starts with if. So it will read, the computer will read the condition in brackets behind the if. And then depending on if this condition is true or false, if it's fulfilled or not fulfilled, it will go into this block and execute everything you read here. So everything you read between the curly brackets, the opening curly bracket and the closing curly bracket form a block. And this block is executed in case the condition is true. And then afterwards, it will anyway, independent from this condition, it will continue reading down here and executing all the operations you wrote down there. In case it hits this line and the condition is not true, it will jump the block and execute the code afterwards. So this is what the if statement does. And there is a more extended version of that. It's the so-called if-else statement. And there is another block. So again, we see here one block, opening curly bracket, closing curly bracket. The code block in between is executed when the condition is true. If the condition is not true, instead of this block, the block behind the else will be executed. So all the code between these two curly brackets here. So you see that the curly brackets mean something. They put code together in a block, and these blocks are executed depending on the condition. And you can see that I'm indenting the code here. I do this because my eyes are trained of reading code blocks, so things which happen under different conditions, if it is indented. So if I see, okay, this condition here is wrong, if I just by reading the code, right, if I see, okay, this condition is wrong, so it's false, it will be not executed, I can jump to the next line where the else is coming without having to read everything here in detail. And this jump I can do with my eye because of this indentation. So this indentation helps me reading the code, and that's why I'm also suggesting you to use indentation to make your code easier to read. Yeah, and then there's one special thing with if statements. So there are something like three statements in ImageJ which do not deserve a semicolon here by the end. If there would be a semicolon here at this particular point, this semicolon would end the block. So that would mean that if you put a semicolon here, ImageJ will not understand these curly brackets anymore. That's why this is one of the three situations where the semicolon is not necessary. And there are different operators for actually, or different ways of writing these conditions. So this is now about what we can write here in these curly brackets, in these round brackets. So for example, we can write quality larger than 99.9, and then in this particular case, this block would be executed. So print, everything is fine. Or in the else statement, if the quality is not as high as that, we need to improve. So let's see what other operators we have. So it's like this is typical comparison operators. Important is here that the equal operator, in order to compare A to B, you have to write two equal signs. The equal symbol alone, just one, is the assignment operator, putting a value into a variable. For comparing variables, that's a different mathematical operation, right? You have to write two equal signs, and not equal to is the exclamation mark equal. The others are quite intuitive. Furthermore, you can combine conditions, so that's a bit advanced, but I nevertheless wanted to show you. For example, if you want to check if A is smaller than B and B is smaller than C, so if B is between C and A, you have to write it like that with the AND operator. Furthermore, there is a not operator. If something is not true, if you want to negate it, you can use the exclamation mark. I know this looks complicated, especially for those among you who program for the very first time. I think you won't need it at the very beginning. I just wanted to tell you that it exists and how it works, so you can at any point in time come back to this slide and have a look. It's also in the cheat sheet. And let's try that out a bit. Okay, so I have a variable. Let's define the variable quality. Quality has a value of 90%, for example. I can also write, it's helpful, my physical unit behind here to just know. I can also adapt the name so that it actually contains the physical unit. Yeah, and you may agree that a variable called quality in percent is much more meaningful than Q, right? So that's why name your variables in an appropriate way. And I will now check if the quality in percent has a certain value. Again, the auto-completion helps me here. I don't have to write every character myself. I'm just using the auto-completion in order to get my variable here. If I want to, for example, check if the quality in percent lies between 80 and 100, let's say do it something like this, we can write it like that. If quality is larger than 80 and quality is smaller than 100, then we will print something out like good. And we will execute this program. And we don't see a result. Ooh, what's going wrong? So you see also I'm sometimes a little bit confused. And that has something to do with the fact that the log window is not around. Yeah, so it was printing good. Just saying, sometimes you may get lost between all the windows which are on your screen, and that's normal. That's unfortunate, but there's a solution for this. So this looks now again. That looks a bit complicated because I was using quite some operators, and this line also becomes a bit long. For beginners, I would recommend writing it in this way, because it's at the beginning easier to learn. So if you want to check two things, you can also write it like that. So you first check if the quality is larger than 80, and then you check if the quality is below 100. The quality above 100 would be amazing, right? And we can also print that with an else block. Yeah, and you see already when you put different if statements into each other, right? Program can become quite complicated. What is happening in which case, and what if the quality is 79? That might become complicated when you write long code, and that's why this indentation here is so important. So the rule is after every opening curly bracket, you indent all the code which belongs to it, you indent once. And if another opening curly bracket comes, you indent it again. And you see how I was doing it? It's intuitive. I don't think about it anymore. I'm doing it automatically. So it's not like I think much about it. But with reading, it helps me a lot. Reading code like this is harder. Later on, you will agree on that. That's why, as early as possible, try to adapt your writing style to do this indentation correctly as early as possible. And if you change code, always check if the indentation is still right. If you put another if in there, indent everything correctly to make it easy to read for yourself. Yeah, and to just elaborate a bit on that, does this program say yin or yang? Unfortunately, we are not in the same lecture hall at the moment and can discuss about that. So there are some if statements put into each other. There are also variables on top. You may also agree that saying e equals 5 and b equals 3 and c equals 8 all in one line, separated with a semicolon. So this code will execute. It's okay. It's perfect ImageJ macro, but it's maybe not so easy to read, right? How about this program? I hope you agree that it's easier to read. So the first question the program asks is b larger than 0? And I can just go up and I see here, b is 3. Okay, fine. So we will go into this block. We don't have to jump here. We have to go into the block starting with the curly bracket, and now we read the continuing part. So it says, if a equals 5, let's look up what a is. And we go up and we search for a equals something, and we find it here. A equals 5, so this is true. It will print ying, for sure. But we should not stop you. The program continues. It's not the ending part, right? So the else block is not executed because the if block was executed. So we jump this part. We do not execute it. And we go here and we check if D is not equal to 0. So let's find out where is D set. And we go up and read D equals and we find a mathematical equation, which we have to perform. At the end, it's 8 divided by 8. It's 1. So D is not equal to 0, so it will also print out yang, yin and yang, right? So, and I hope you agree that this is much more obvious and easier to read on the right side compared to the left side. So as a long-term programmer and also teacher of young programmers, I ask you, please, indent your code. It's good for you. And that brings us to the point how to write readable code. So we have just seen it. Every command belongs on its own line. If you go through code and you search for the line where the value of the variable b is set, you will not find it if it's written like that. It's super hard to spot. But when you write your code like this and the b and the equal sign is at the beginning of the line, it's easier to find. So please write your code like this. Every command, every action, every assignment belongs on its own line. Furthermore, between different blocks of code, so for example, here you have some initialization part, then you do some algorithm execution, some math, and then there's some other part coming. Put some empty lines in between, just to like a new paragraph of a text you're writing, but you're writing code, you're writing a program. Put empty lines. If the context is changing, if something new is happening, put an empty line in between. And also, please put spaces between the characters and operators. It makes it for you easier to read. You may agree that also sentences are easier to read if they contain spaces. So that's in human language the same as in programming languages. So put these spaces there in order to ease your life. Use the indentation, using the tab key, by the way, in order to make the code easier to read for yourself. And you can put the curly brackets behind and on front, but that's a matter of taste, actually. So if you write it like this, or if you write it like that, does not matter. But I think I was expressing here on that slide my personal opinion. And make use of tools. So if you wrote a long piece of code, or if you got a long piece of code from a collaborator which is not properly indented, you can, for example, use this website, and I bet there are more websites which offer the same service. Furthermore, troubleshooting. You saw it earlier. If your program throws an error message, don't click it away immediately. Read it. Look carefully at what it means, in which line is it happening. So it tells you always which line. The line may not be 100% correct. It may be the line before or after. So that depends sometimes a bit. So look around line number 9 in this particular case. Furthermore, it also tells you what is might be missing. So in this case, it's missing a character. It's missing a bracket. Maybe it misses something else and it doesn't know. But you at least know that you have to look for something that's missing. That's not where it is supposed to be. Furthermore, also within this line, it tries to tell you where it is. This smaller than and larger than symbols here, it tells you that there is something wrong close to this print statement. So this is what this error message is trying to tell you here. So yeah, don't panic, right? There are two ways to write error-free programs, but only the third one works. Alan J. Pallas, I think he was the founder of the first computer science faculty in Yale. And so he must be right when he says things like that, right? Yeah, read where the error was happening, read what was wrong, and don't take the error messages too strict because they were also just programmed by a human. Okay, this was the if statement. We also trained it a bit. Let's now look at the loop because we want to execute operations several times. So this is what the loop is doing, right? So we started an image, we go through a complex workflow, and then we go back And we can again go through this workflow, or we can at some point decide to leave the program, right? So this is what a loop is doing. So for loops in ImageJ work like that, and they consists usually of a typical tuple of things. So we have here an initializer, we have a condition. You already learned what a condition is. A condition is the same thing as it happens behind the if. And we have an iterator. So initializer, condition, iterator, and no semicolon. This is one of the cases where there is no semicolon here, because if we put a semicolon here, the for loop would end at this particular point, but we want to use it this block behind. So please don't put a semicolon here. So this is an example for a for loop. And we see again these three things. This is our initializer, this is our condition, and this is our iterator. The computer comes and reads this code, it just did something, and it arrives at the for statement. At the for statement, when it reads that, it starts with the initializer. So it will first set the variable I to the value 0. Then it will check the condition we put there. Is I smaller than 10? It is. So yes. This means, okay, the code is executed. And what it means is that the code inside the for loop, so to do something for 10 times, this is executed now once. And afterwards, it will increase the counter, it will execute the iterator. And then it will check the condition again, and it will do it again. What I++ means, sorry for this one, what I++ means, it increases I by 1. You find this operator, that's an operator, the increment operator, you find it on a cheat sheet. And it does it again and again and again. It checks the condition, executes the code, then increases the I and checks again and so on. The point is here that the initializer is only executed once, and the other two, the condition and the iterator, are executed several times. Until at some point I becomes 10, and then this condition is no longer true, and then it will leave the for loop and will continue the code afterwards, right? So this is what a for loop does. Just to summarize it again, the initializer is executed only once at the very beginning. Immediately afterwards, the condition is checked, then the code in the loop is executed, and by the end, the iterator is executed, before the condition is checked again. I wrote here an alternative to I++ is this one. I plus equals 1. Increase I by 1. This is what this operator does. Find out for yourself which one is more convenient for you to read and understand. And when you write for loops, it might sometimes be helpful to trace down a bug. So you may come into a situation where the for loop is not doing what you are thinking it should do, and then you should use the following strategy when working with code. So let's assume we have this program and we want it to print some numbers. So that's what I'm just reading out the comment here, right? So we want it to print out some numbers. We don't know yet in detail what it does, and we are also don't know yet what start and end do. So we just look at this part of the program and we ignore the rest, right? So we don't know, maybe there is something wrong with it. And I execute this program, the log window stays empty. The question is now why? And you may come to this point, right? You wrote a piece of code and it's not doing what it's supposed to do. And again, I'm a software developer, and that's what I do every day, tracing bugs. And this is how I do. So the very first part would be, we want to know what start and end are. So we have here two variables, start and end, and we don't know what value is in there, so we print it out. Yeah, so we print out start and end, and so we can read in the log window, okay, and here you can see, okay, this for loop is supposed to run from 0 to 10. Okay, fine. But it is still not printing out anything. But I would expect that some numbers, so there's also an if statement here, I would expect that some numbers fulfill this condition. Some numbers are larger than 5 if you go from 0 to 10, right? So we can also pr put another print statement in here, for example here, into the for loop to just see if the computer is going into this for loop and is actually doing something in there. When we execute this program, we don't read this line. So, and this is how I interpret the situation now. This code is executed. We see it in the log window. This code is not executed because we do not see it in the log window. So the problem must be in the line in between. So we can kind of reduce the part of the program which was not working. So the program is 100 lines long, right? And now we know this one particular line where there is an issue. And this is how we do that. And then we have to read this particular line in very detail and very carefully. And we will realize that I used the wrong operator here. So if we turn this guy around, the program suddenly executes. And it also prints out some numbers between 5 and 10. And you will also see that it is printing this. Is it ever printed? Is it ever printed again and again? So part of the tracing of the bug is, after you found the bug in your program, please remove the traces. Yeah. So clean up your program after doing this. Otherwise, your log window will be filled with trash after some time. So remove these lines again to get your program back. If you want to go through a folder of files, the files are represented as arrays. We will go through arrays. I will show you arrays in more detail next week. For now, you should know that an array is kind of a list of things, like file names, where you can iterate through. So we can use this built-in macro method, which is called getFileList from a folder. And then we have here in this list, we have a list of files. And we can also find out how many files there are by calling the length of method and handing over the list. So we can ask how many files are in that folder. Then we can go from 0 until the number of files in that folder and get a file name for every of these files. And then we can open all these images and process them. This is what you will need later in the exercise. So for going through a folder of files, you use this particular way of navigating through a folder. And while we have a rectangular bracket here to access the ith file name in this list, I will explain you a bit more in detail next week. Yeah, but for printing out, for example, images like that, and this is how you should get started later in the exercise, you also again find the code in the folder where also the slides are. And to just go through a list of files in a folder, you can do like this. And before I sum up for today, write readable code. Reading and writing are like yin and yang when it comes to coding. So programming is not writing. Programming is reading and writing. And that's why please put comments into your program to make it easier to read for yourself. Put spaces, because otherwise you cannot read your own code. And indent blocks, and you use curly brackets in the context of if statements and for loops. So this is kind of best practice in writing programs. So with that, I come to the exercises I would like to ask you to do until the Zoom meeting next week. So first of all, of course, run your first macro. Open the script editor and start typing. Do some hello world programming. Use some variables. Do some calculations. Get a bit used to how this works. Then the second challenge would be, please write a program which executes this algorithm. So you have to find out how the mathematical operations are called in order to write a program which can execute this algorithm. And then play a bit with the macro language. Try out combining strings and numbers and do different mathematical operations like add numbers and strings. And try to divide numbers and strings and see what's happening here, and just try to get a bit of feeling for that. It's a matter of trying, a matter of learning by doing. Then I have an example for loop here. You can take the program I already wrote for you, but you can also type it yourself as it's still short, right? And try to program a for loop which goes backwards from a given number to 0. Okay, and then there is the big exercise for this week. So you find a folder with many images, I think it's around 60, from Anne, thanks Anne by the way, of these yeast cells which are changing their shape over time. And I would like you to write a little program which does segmentation of these objects and measures their shape. Remember, use thresholding, erosion, dilation, connected components analysis, and measurements of shape in this particular case, and apply this program to the first frame, apply it to the 20th frame, see what the recorder is recording when you are processing it, and try to record a program, try to write a program which can process not just the first frame, but also the 20th frame, and comes to some measurements, comes to some reasonable conclusions about the shape of these objects in the image. Also take care that when you get a binary image out, the white objects, the yeast cells, should have value 255 and the background should have value 0. Check that from time to time, because some ImageJs have an issue here. I'm not sure exactly why. If this is not true, you have to invert the binary image. The goal is to have the objects being 255 and background 0. And yeah, of course, again, try to write a good program, try to put some comments in between, put some empty lines in between so that you can later also read your own program. After you've done that, after you wrote your program which processes one particular image, you put it into a for loop, so you see here maybe a for. and you should also use an if statement. I hope you all find out why and what for. I will not spoil too much now, because I also would like you to discover why this if statement here is necessary, but the hint should be there. And then afterwards, please take the measurements you save into a table and plot them in Excel. I would say the result of the shape over time should rather look like this, so it's changing at the beginning and then it's not changing anymore. Should rather look like that and not like this plot. And I left the axis descriptions out because I would like you to discover which feature you extracted is the right one to describe shape in a good way. Optional exercise for those of you who are already used to programming. You analyze the banana dataset, please, and you plot the position of the banana slice in space. Should approximately look like this. Yeah, and one more hint again. I mean, I'm repeating here. If you run into trouble, you can drop me an email, sure, I'm happy to help, but you can also ask me or other experts in the forum, as I did it last year when we were doing this exercise in the lecture hall. I had some issues with saving the table. So it's the save table command, it's like save as results and then the file name, wasn't working for me. So I asked them and I told them, okay, the recorder doesn't work, this is my example code. And then I was discussing with ImageJan from Basel, and he was putting some suggestions. So that's really like, we discuss a bit until we come to a point how it works. And I think that was then some days after Wayne Respin, the developer of ImageJ himself, answered, Robert, you're using the wrong version of ImageJ. So that happens. And I'm also just a human. I'm just saying, if you struggle with image processing in this exercise or with image processing in general, go to the forum, post your code there. The code for analyzing some banana slices is not a heavy research thing. Just put your code there and ask the people to help you. And it's not just me. There are many people helping out you with these rather simple programming questions, at least now at the beginning. Okay, that's it for this week. I know it was heavy. I showed you a lot of stuff. Feature extraction, then image shape, macro conditions, loops, working with files and the macro recorder. It's a lot of stuff. That's why take a bit of your time to go through this step by step. Try out these things individually. Play with variables. Play with conditions. Write a simple for loop before you try to program the big thing, right? So step by step. Next week, I will show you a bit more in detail how you can program working with the RI manager and working with tables. And I will show you some advanced coding stuff. And then we will continue working with the same data set we are working with this week. So please write a good program. Put some comments into your program so that you can then a week or 2 weeks later still read your own program. We will continue working on this one and make a visual representation of the shape of these yeast cells automatically. Okay, with that, see you next week.